Come on now, I know people are here other than Dr. Morrow. Let's try this again. Good morning. Welcome to the Dental Board of California quarterly meeting. Today is Thursday, August 15th. I want to ask first if those of you at the dais, if you will put your cell phones on silent and make sure they're off the table so we can avoid any feedback noises. And for those of you in the audience, this is an official meeting of the Dental Board of California. The board welcomes public comment on any item on the agenda, and it is the board's intent to ask for public comment prior to the board taking action on an agenda item. If for some reason I forget, and you wish to speak on that item, please raise your hand and you will be recognized. Depending on the number of people who would like to testify on a particular item, a time limit may be imposed. We ask all speakers to please stay on topic, and if a time limit is determined to be necessary, keep your comments to within that limit. So, with that, I'd like to call this meeting to order and ask the board secretary to call the roll.
Thank you, Madam President. And welcome this morning to the continuing saga of the Dental Board of California. Burton.
Here.
Burton present, Chan present, Chappelle Ingram absent. Lai.
Here.
Lai here. Laren.
Here.
Laren here. Lay.
Here.
Lay here. Mackenzie.
Here.
Mackenzie here. Medina. Absent. Morrow.
Here.
Morrow present. Alagi.
Here.
Alagi present. Pacheco. Pacheco absent. Stewart. Stewart present. Witcher.
Here.
Witcher present. You.
Yes.
You present. Madam President, you have a quorum.
Thank you. The next item, and for those of you who are following the hard copies, is approval of the May 15th, 16th, and the July 23rd board meeting minutes. Let's start on page 7. It began from page 7 to 24. Any comments?
I have a couple of suggestions. Page 10, last line, it says that, and Ms. McCune is here, she can maybe help me with this. It says that she provided a report that there was a 34% increase in the cures requirement. I think that's cures registration. Maybe that, it just, that doesn't, I'm not quite sure what that means.
Dr. Witcher, you need to be more specific on where you're looking.
The last line of the last paragraph on page 10 of the minutes.
Public comment.
Under?
The last line reads, Ms. McCune provided a report that there was a 34% increase in cures requirement with the TDIC. Is that cures registration or? I'm not quite sure what
okay.
That.
Oh, okay. So, just clarification.
Yeah.
Let's go by the meeting materials page number at the very bottom.
Oh, okay.
So you're
sure,
on.
Sure.
You're actually on page.
Page 16. I'm sorry. Okay. Correct.
Okay.
Anyway, and then on page 13. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me make sure I have the right page in the.
I'm sorry, could you repeat your comment on what your first comment?
Yes, it's unclear to me what that sentence means. It states there was a 34% increase in the cure's requirement. I don't think the requirement changed, and I'm not sure what that has to do with TDIC. I think there was a 34% increase in cure's registration, but I'm not sure what TDIC has to do with that. Maybe we need to go back and listen to the tape again on that.
Mary McCune, CDA. So the report that I provided at the last meeting was showing that due to the TDIC materials that we posted about the cure's registration requirements, there was a 34% increase in registration.
Okay, so for members, just for clarification, you want to strike a requirement and make that registration. Okay.
And then I had one more on page 19. The middle paragraph, Mary McCune, CDA, commented that there is a change in terminology, adhesive protective restorations to interim adhesive protective restorations. I think that should read interim therapeutic restorations to interim adhesive protective restorations. In other words, adhesive protective restorations was not a term that was used. It should be ITRs or interim therapeutic restorations.
Anything else? Any
And this is more for procedural, maybe to ask the attorney. I had to recuse myself for the July 23rd meeting. So do we unbundle a motion for both the 2 minutes? In other words, do it separately?
Yes, that's acceptable.
Okay. Okay. any public comment?
Good morning. Okamoto, CDHA. I have a question on page 19 and 20, just for clarification. On 19, it says, move second carry to accept language and work with Executive Officer Karen Fisher. And then on the following page, it says the motion failed.
Hang on just a minute. On page 19, is this at the bottom, the motion?
Correct.
And your question is?
I was not present at that meeting, and I'd like clarification. It says, move second carried, but on the following page it says the motion failed. Did it carry or did it fail? Okay, so should that say MSF? move second failed?
So noted.
Thank you.
Anything else? Okay, let's, is there a motion to approve?
So
move Morrow, second?
Witcher, second.
Witcher?
Okay, and the motion is to separate out the
the May 15th, 16th meeting as the first motion. Morrow moved it, and Whitcher second. Burton.
Aye.
Burton, aye. Chan, aye. Chappelle Ingram, absent. Lay.
Aye.
Laren.
Aye.
Laren, aye. Lay. Bye.
Yes.
I did it backwards. Yeah, I had it backwards, sorry. McKenzie.
Yes.
McKenzie, yes. Medina. Medina, absent. Morrow.
Aye.
Morrow, aye. Alagi.
Yes.
Alagi, yes. Pacheco, absent. Stewart.
Yes.
Stewart, yes. Witcher.
Yes.
Witcher, yes. You.
Yes.
Yes. Motion passes.
Okay, now I didn't hear a vote. Did you do lay and lie?
Yes, I did. I reversed it.
Okay.
Okay, and then the second part of the item is the July 23rd meeting. And just so I can ask the question, do we need a second motion? And okay.
Move Burton.
Second, Witcher.
Okay. Burton?
Aye.
Burton, aye. Chan, abstain. Chappelle Ingram, absent. Lai?
Yes.
Lai, yes. Laren?
Yes.
Laren, yes. Lay?
Yes.
Lay, yes. McKenzie?
Yes.
McKenzie, yes. Medina, absent. Morrow?
Yes.
Morrow, yes. Alagi?
Yes.
Alagi, yes. Pacheco, absent. Stewart?
Yes.
Stewart, yes. Witcher?
Yes.
Witcher, yes. You?
Yes.
You, yes. Motion passes, Madam President.
Thank you. Next item is President Welcome and Report. So good morning again. This is our third meeting. And the year continues to be busy, particularly with our focus on sunset review. Additionally, we continue to follow legislation as the legislature has returned from summer recess, and regulations, enforcement, examination issues, and other matters as they arise. The past months have been filled with many telephone calls with the executive officer. Additionally, on July 1st, Karen and I attended the Senate Business and Professions Committee meeting to speak in support of AB 16 Low, a bill we supported if amended in our last meeting. That bill became a two-year bill. On July 12th, Karen and I attended a briefing on the executive officer salary report. If you recall, DCA engaged a firm for the purposes of analysis, a benchmark study, survey, and among other charges to look at the salary of executive officers in other states. While I won't give you a lot of detail, in all my candor, I will say that I am as frustrated today as when this process began. The next steps appear to be long rather than short term, and whatever further evaluation is needed doesn't get to the bottom line for me. There is an inequity with this board and we were concerned during the last sunset process. I mean, this is something that really puts this issue in perspective for me. So the last sunset process, I was president then, and it was an issue that we brought up at that time. The end result is that DCA, the end result of the meeting that we had is that DCA has said that it will set up individual meetings with board presidents and executive officers If there are things that come out of that meeting, I will get back to you. But the bottom line is that we're not any further along than we were. On July 23rd, the board had a teleconference, the minutes of which we just approved in the packet. And lastly, yesterday, Karen and Sarah Wallace and I had a meeting with Chair Lowe, the Assembly BNP Committee, before traveling here to respond to additional questions about our sunset report and our bill. I also wanted to report this from our oral health partners at the Department of Health Care Services. $10.5 million has been allocated to pay off student loans for 40 dentists who have agreed to ensure that 30% of their caseload as practicing dentists will be with Medi-Cal patients. This will go a long way in addressing the dental needs of low-income and underserved communities. We're not there yet, but every little step helps in this process. Lastly, I want to congratulate our colleague, Dr. Hung Mei, and the successful dedication of the Oakland Dental and Wellness Clinic. Dr. Lei is a pioneer in showing innovation in serving the community through her community clinic. You have our congratulations on that. So as we begin this meeting, I'd like to do a reminder of our charge. The priority of the board is protection of the public. It is our highest priority in exercising our licensing, regulation, and disciplinary functions. Whenever the protection of the public is inconsistent with other interests sought to be promoted, the protection of the board shall be paramount. The Dental Practice Act is our guide. We are charged with the administration of the Dental Practice Act, and we have the privilege to be selected to represent the state of California. So, members, I ask that you do due diligence to be prepared to participate fully in this meeting. To our partners who represent some part of dentistry and dental assisting, you're here because you represent various constituencies and have a stake in what we do. I will make every attempt to hear your concerns. Sometimes our interests and the decisions we make may be different from what you may want because of your guiding principle. When that is the case, I'm hopeful that we can agree to disagree without being disagreeable. As we go through this agenda in this next 2 days, I want to hear from members of the public. I want to hear from our members. There may be times when you may be limited, and we will make you aware of that as well. So I'm going to thank you in advance for your cooperation with that. Also during the meeting, you will see members accessing devices. We are also making an attempt to come more into the electronic age, and so you will see members accessing devices, and that is to get to look at the agendas. So I'm going to ask again that if you have other devices, that you silence those. And I'm going to ask our guests and partners to do the same, and also ask if you have conversations that you keep those at a respectable tone so as not to be disruptive of others. I'm looking forward to a good meeting. I neglected earlier to acknowledge Michael Knope, our counsel. So welcome. Welcome.
Thank you, Madam President.
And so, yes, and Pahua, if you will raise your hand over. This is our new administrative assistant. And so for those of you who have not met her, please make yourself known to her. And you'll see her moving around. She's already been moving around doing a lot. So thank you and welcome. One other little piece of business, there is a lunch menu in front of you. If you, when you get a minute, if you will indicate what you want for lunch, I think we're going to try to pre-order, right? Okay. So I'm going to ask that we move on to this next item, which is item 4. And I understand that we're going to delay this until the president gets here. So I'll keep my eye out for her. So the next thing is the budget report.
Good morning, board members. Wilbur Rimbaugh with the Dental Board. I will be providing an update of the Dental Board and the Dental Assisting Council, and be providing an update of the budget for both programs. The board manages two separate funds, the State Dentistry Fund and the Dental Assisting Fund. The funds are not commingled. The following is intended to provide a summary of expenses from July 1st, 2018 to June 30th, 2019. Fiscal year 2018-19 for both funds. First item is the dental board. The dental board's current budget, the board's prior budget for fiscal year 18-19 was $14.1 million. And of that $14.1 million, the board expended $12.4 million, which resulted in spending 88% of its total fund. Of that 88%, $6.9 million was spent for personnel services and $5.5 million was spent for operating equipment and expenditures. Moving on to the Dental Assisting Fund. Again, this is an update for fiscal year 18-19. The Dental Assisting Fund, their budget was roughly $2.6 million, and of that, the dental assisting program spent $1.9 million, so it spent approximately 78% of its budget. Of that 78%, $1.9 million was spent for the personnel services, and $1.1 million was spent for operating equipment and expenses. The following attached documents, it will provide additional details in terms of line-by-line items of what the board has spent. I know there's a lot of red on there, but typically what we look for is bottom-line budget, but the board reverted $1.7 million.
A question about the red that's on fingerprinting, especially. Is that to bring us up to speed? Will that kind of goal be significantly reduced after a while?
Yes, we are actually working with the department. Those were all these scheduled reimbursements were prior dollar amounts that we had done in probably over 5 years ago. And so we're looking to update these reimbursement items. And we are working with the budget office to update those.
Jan.
Point of information. see how to frame this. First of all, commend the executive officer for coming under budget, but is there potential shortcoming or shortfall in petitioning for the next year's budget since we came under budget?
At this point, we do not anticipate any shortfalls. There are a couple of items that have been brought to us by the budget office and the department, and as we've calculated into our current fund condition, the board will be sufficient.
Well, what I'm asking, to be more specific, if we come under budget, will the legislature say, you don't need that much, we're going to give you less?
That is not...
Typically, as you know, we've been trying to build up our reserve. So this money, whatever we don't spend at the end of the year, we don't lose. It goes back into the reserve. And I think, as we've explained before, oftentimes what we're appropriated to spend doesn't necessarily correlate with what we do actually spend. So typically, the budget office reviews our budget entirely, goes back and looks at prior years. But typically, the budget will be expanded by the governor by at least a cost of living type of expansion. So we're still in good shape, and I'll be reporting later, but I'll mention it now. We're expanding our space, which is going to cost money. We entered into a new lease agreement that is going to cost money. We're getting fully staffed, which is going to cost money. So we are working up to spending our full expenditure, while at the same time, we still need to build up our reserves. Is that a little more detail?
Yes, so we get to keep it then.
We get to keep it, yeah.
And I don't think there's ever been a case where we've had funds taken away. We've had some years back when the state was in poor financial condition, we had a loan against the money that we had in reserve, and that all has been paid back. But I don't think we've had a case that I know of where we've had funds withdrawn from us.
And if at some point the budget office determines that we have too much in reserve, then they would want us to do a reverse BCP, essentially, to decrease the renewal fees. I believe that's happened by a couple of boards, but it doesn't happen very often.
Okay.
Yeah, again, I just notice a declining number of months in reserve with both funds, and, you know, the budget and audit report suggested a 4-month to 6-month figure. We're down to 3, which I don't think is a problem because our funding is stable, and it's somewhat different than something that entity that's subject to a lot of budget fluctuations. In other words, you know, some of the associations, if they have a bad year, they could really have to draw down their reserves. That's unlikely to happen here, but I just point it out as a trend.
So this quarter, did we spend more money? It seems like we spent more this quarter than last. According to these figures, it seems a lot closer. The appropriation and the total expenditure seems closer at this time.
I will have to break it down by quarter, but this is a year-end report for fiscal year 18-19. As of July 1st, we have a new budget, quote-unquote.
Okay.
So I can go back to the office and I can look at
the quarterly. This
breakdown
number seemed bigger. The disparity was bigger this time. So I didn't understand where that all came from, and I didn't know how it was broken down.
I'm going to have to look back at that, but the current appropriation, the budget, that's always, you know, been the budget for the year.
Mm-hmm. And no, the expenditure spent, part.
Yeah, but the expenditure part for in terms of year end, mm-hmm. that's just the total for last year. But like I said, I would have to go back and do an actual breakdown, like, of quarterly what was spent for that
okay.
time.
So I know it fluctuates from quarter to quarter.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any public comment? Move acceptance of the report.
The next item is the attachments for the dental assisting program. The dental assisting program reverted approximately $561,000 for fiscal year 18-19.
That's attachment 2A?
Yes.
Okay.
Attachment 2, I'm sorry.
Okay. Page 33, everybody.
Any questions on the dental assisting program budget?
Public comment? Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Tony, any ETA, or can we move to our next item? Okay. Okay. So then let's move to the Dental Assistant Council meeting. And I need members to leave the dais, please.
Good morning. I'd like to begin the Dental Assisting Committee portion of the Dental Board meeting. You want to call roll, Sarah, or do you want me to?
Contreras?
Here.
Olagi?
Here.
Overd?
Here.
Peacock? Absent. Rodriguez?
Here.
Witcher?
Here.
We have a quorum.
Okay, we'll go to item number two, which is our update on dental assisting program and course applications.
Good morning, Tina Valerie, manager of the dental assisting unit. I will be presenting the dental assisting program and course application update. This memo provides an overview of the new dental assisting program and course applications received by the board. Table 1 shows the total number of dental assisting program and course applications that have been approved in 2019. Table 2 shows the number of RDA and RDAEF program site visits conducted in 2019. Table 3 is an overview of the status of each application received. Table 4 shows the total number of approved programs and courses. Table 5 identifies approved DA program or course providers by name and type of program. And Table 6 identifies the DA approved program and course trends for the applications received in 2019. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Okay, any public comment?
Hi, I'm Dr. Guy Atchison. I'm representing California Academy of General Dentistry. I had a question about the dental sedation assistant courses. Currently, it seems the only courses are ones that are sort of put on privately by oral surgery offices that are kind of committed to developing a staff position with that qualification. I'm also have had the privilege of being an on-site examiner for conscious sedation as long as the programs existed. And it seems that there would be a great benefit to having a dental sedation assistant course more available so that those practitioners that aren't practicing general anesthesia but still depend upon staff to help monitor patients and provide a safe environment would benefit from that kind of course. And since the course seems to be limited to just these private general anesthesia courses, I'd like you to consider that. One of the things that, go ahead. Okay, well, that's the basic thing. I think there's a need in the state of California for expanded training for assistants in assisting in sedation, especially lower levels of sedation. And right now, that's really not available.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Dr. Witcher.
Yeah, I'd like to respond to that. Yeah, we've been aware of that since the beginning. When the DSA was conceived, a lot of the dental assisting programs were interested in teaching it. However, their administration was unwilling to take it on due to insurance considerations. Since that time, we've been trying to get people to offer the course outside their practices, but it's a big commitment. There are some clinical case supervision that has to be done, and how that is done in somebody else's office had to be worked out. There is one program now offering this, and interestingly enough, it is the sponsoring permit holder is a conscious sedation permit holder. That's Dental Assisting Specialties. They have an office in San Jose, and they also have a branch in Southern California. So I don't know if that, I know that application has been approved. I don't know if they're accepting students yet, but that is the first one that I know. There are, we're continuing to work on that because we recognize the need. It's just that logistics of doing it have been something of a challenge, and we haven't been able to find anybody to take it on. But we're acutely aware of that problem, and we'd really like to see in we gave a lot of encouragement to dental assisting specialties to open up a course like that.
Well, perhaps one thing that could be pursued is trying to utilize online learning to take care of perhaps the didactic component and make it a little easier then for those of us that are practicing in our offices to provide the hands-on part while we're working with patients. So, you know, if there were a credentialing agency that could verify the quality of the online didactic component, that would be quite helpful, I think.
Yeah, I can give you all the information you need. I think you and I need to have a sidebar about that, and I'll tell you, I'll answer your questions.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Item number three, update on RDA program evaluations.
Tina Valerie, manager of the dental assisting program. This memo provides an overview of the reevaluations that are currently underway and the status of each reevaluation. We have also included a brief overview of the reevaluation process. Due to feedback we received from stakeholders regarding concern that programs were struggling with this process and that they were concerned with the amount of time given to respond to the board's request, along with other questions about requirements, board staff made the decision to suspend new requests for reevaluations. This was decided to give the current programs undergoing a reevaluation and board staff the opportunity to address any areas of concern. On May 3rd and May 10th, board staff hosted two informational workshops to go over the reevaluation process and to allow programs the opportunity to ask questions about the process. Additionally, board staff went over the expectations of the programs and the common deficiencies. Attendees were given the contact information of board staff and management in case programs needed additional support. Based on information provided to board staff regarding suggested improvements to the process, we have been working on developing a new application specifically for the reevaluation process, as well as a checklist to clearly identify the needed items. Any additional issues that have been brought to our attention have been taken seriously, and we have been working on the suggested improvements. This process is new and is a work in progress, and we will continue to make the necessary adjustments in the process as we go. And I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Have you noticed any improvement on any of the applications since May, since the two meetings in Northern and Southern?
So we haven't sent out any new requests since then. So the workshops were intended to give the information. So when we do begin to send out the requests again, those programs had an idea of what was coming and what the process was going to be like. But we have since then received several communications from program directors that are going through the process to ask questions and clarify items.
Okay. I noticed on a couple of the programs that had deficiencies, how, and they asked for an extension, how long do you give those extensions and how long is the deficiency? I noticed that some of the letters were mailed out in September of 18 and they're still deficient. So how long of a process is that usually?
So we haven't had like a set amount of time that we've given programs. It's been a case-by-case basis. Some of the programs struggled because it was summer break and they weren't going to be in the office, and so they needed additional time. So I guess the answer is it just depended on what they were asking for, and we've been trying to just work with them on a case-by-case basis and as needed. If they needed more time, they're told to let us know, and we've been really trying to just walk them through the process right now.
And there's no time limit on that deficiency or anything? It's just working with the programs then?
Well, I mean, we do have a time frame. If they ask for an extension, then that's what we're expecting from them. Okay. But if something else comes up, which we haven't really had too many of those situations where they've asked for a second extension, but if they do and it's a relevant reason, then we've been trying to take that into consideration.
Okay.
Yes, Dr. Witcher?
Yeah, you have to understand this is a new process and that some of the programs have been in existence for 20 or more years and they've been operating off a curriculum all that time, and to go back and recreate essentially a new curriculum that would comply with all the new educational regulations that passed a few years ago is a pretty big job. And because this is actually never, we've never reapproved programs in the past, there's bound to be some struggles along the way. And I'd like to thank staff for hanging in there and working with the programs to overcome these problems. And I think we'll have a much smoother process. You know, whether we can keep on track and do this every 7 years, I have my doubts. But if we could get through it once, it's bound to help.
Thank you. Ann?
Okay, Tina, now I know this list is for programs only. I was just wondering if eventually down the line, if you guys are going to do reevaluations of standalone courses as well?
So my answer is that for sure that's something that we want to get into eventually, but definitely starting with the programs was the, I guess, more urgent matter. So that is definitely something we're hoping to do in the future, but have not made plans for that as of today.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any public comment?
Poll CDAA. I'd just like to reiterate what Dr. Witcher said, that we really appreciate staff's work on this issue and their responsiveness to our comments, and we are continuing dialogue and we look forward to having the process streamlined down the road and the kinks worked out. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, item number 4, update on dental assisting examination statistics.
Currently, the board offers 4 written examinations, the RDA combined general written and law and ethics exam, the RDA EF written, the orthodontic assistant permit written, and the dental sedation assistant permit written exam. This memo provides an overview of the candidates that have been tested over the last 12 months and the passing and failing scores for each exam. The tables also break down each examination by first-time and repeat candidates and their passing and failing scores. The board also offers the RDA EF clinical and practical examinations, which were offered in February, March, June, and August of 2019. We didn't include August in this because we just didn't have a chance to get those stats in there. We offer that exam in both Northern and Southern California, and a breakdown of each exam has been included. We have also included numerous pages of statistics that show the passing rates for individual approved programs. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Ann?
Okay. On page C1 of agenda item 4, under written examinations for the orthodontic assistant, I see that the pass rate is 57%. But the repeat candidates is 31%. That is shocking to me because I would think that it would increase the percentage after taking it the second time. Has there been any changes in the examination from these dates?
There has not been.
All right.
Could I speak to that issue? Actually, if you have a good exam, that's what you want to see. The candidates should be successful the first time, and a declining percentage should be success, because it's a good discriminating tool between those that have the knowledge and those who don't. So that's actually what you want to see. I know it seems surprising, but you know, you want to weed out the people who can't pass it on the first go. That means your exam is very efficient.
Thank you.
Okay, any public comment? Okay, thank you. Okay,
Item number five, update on dental, dental assisting licensing statistics.
Okay. The board currently licenses in the dental assisting unit RDAs, RDAEFs, OAs, and DSAs. This memo provides an overview of the current and inactive, delinquent, and canceled licenses. This item also provides the delinquent license aging, a breakdown of licensees per county, and the ratio of RDAs to DDSs licensed within those counties. Beginning on page 4 of the memo, there are tables indicating the number of applications received by the board in 2019, as well as those that have been approved, the number of licenses that have been issued, and the applications that have been canceled, withdrawn, and denied. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Dr. Witcher?
Yeah, just a general comment. If you look at national figures on dental assistants entering the workforce, it's in decline. I mean, we're looking at a shortage. And, you know, we don't want to lower standards, but, you know, we need to do something. And it's going to, like all these problems, there's a lot of facets to it. But I think those who practice dentistry in the community realize that it's very hard to find assistants.
I'd have to agree with that. We've been looking for about 4 months now, and yeah, it's a big struggle.
Can I add, how long is somebody, if there's an inactive license, I realize there's no continuing education requirement on there, can they be inactive for years and years and years, or is there any set time?
So inactive licensees have the opportunity to renew every 2 years, mm-hmm. and they can remain on inactive status as long as they choose to.
Okay, so there's no time frame. When a license is delinquent, how long do you have it be inactive, or not inactive, I mean, how long is there a time frame on when you put it on delinquent and then you cancel it?
So the delinquent status is automatic after their expiration date, mm-hmm. and then it's until they renew. So they could be delinquent for 5 years, and then okay. it would cancel
and
at
then
that
it would
point.
Cancel after 5 years. Okay.
Any public comment? Okay, thank you, Tina. And now item number 6, update regarding the dental assisting comprehensive rulemaking proposal.
Good morning. My name is Sarah Wallace. I'm the Assistant Executive Officer. A quick update. The Dental Assisting Council met on Friday, July 26th to consider the Dental Assisting Comprehensive Rulemaking Proposal. This proposal was developed by staff after having approximately 2.5 years of workshops held by the Dental Assisting Council and stakeholders working together. Comments that the board staff has received over the years from stakeholders was also taken into consideration. And it was staff's first opportunity to really draft it all in a regulatory proposal format and present it to the council for discussion and feedback. And so during the meeting, we discussed all of the regulatory sections that board staff had drafted. There were several areas that staff still needs to work on. We received a lot of great feedback from the council members, identified issues of consistency. So at this point, board staff has gone back. We've gone through the meeting minutes from the July 26th meeting to identify what areas we need to review. We are running a side-by-side comparison of what we currently have in regulation versus what was in the proposal to make sure that we didn't miss anything, and then also going through to ensure that we have all of the comments captured from the council. So, as you all know, it was over 150 pages that we shockingly got through on that day. And so while staff is working on this, we expect to bring it back to the council at a future meeting for final consideration. I'm hopeful it'll be ready for the November meeting at the latest. There is potential, if staff is able to get through it quicker, that we may be holding another special dental assisting council meeting for us to review with the council in the same meeting format so that the board staff gets clear direction on how we want to proceed. After the council finalizes the proposal, and let staff know that it's ready to move on to the board. Staff will present it to the board for the initiation of the rulemaking, and then we will move through the regulatory process. And I'd be happy to answer any questions if you have any today.
Yeah, I'd just like to thank staff for putting together that 160-page volume, and also our stakeholders and council members for reading it in some detail and coming through with specific comments, even on a document that long. It was a lot of work. I know I went through it, and it took me several days. So I just think everybody did a good job, and you know, obviously we still have some work to do, but that was a really good first start.
Thank you. Any public comment? Thank you, Sarah. Okay. At this time, we'd like to ask for any public comment that is not on the agenda. Okay. Seeing none. Future agenda items. Any public comment? Okay. Council members, do we have any comments on items that are not on the agenda? Okay. Meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
Come to order. Deep Chan. On the way. Okay, folks, we are at item number 6. The Dental Assistant Council meeting report.
Okay. Today during our Dental Assisting Council meeting, Tina Valerie updated us on the Dental Assisting Program and course applications. We did have public comment expressing concern. We would like to inquire about more DSA programs, licensing programs. Dr. Witcher also informed him that there were two courses already that have been approved and that maybe they would talk sidebar a little bit more information on that. Tina Valerie also updated us on the program evaluations and overview of the evaluations. She updated us on the dental assisting examination and licensing statistics. Sarah Wallace then updated us regarding the Dental Assisting Council, or I'm sorry, the Dental Assisting Comprehensive Rulemaking Proposal. So on July 26th, the Dental Assisting Council met to review the first draft of the proposal. It was a 150-page document that we were able to get through. We had great feedback from stakeholders and council members. The next step will be that the staff is going to make changes to the document, and where we had brought up any concerns or issues, they're going to be making the changes, then it will be ready to be presented to us on November 11th, if not sooner, during a special meeting. Once the draft is finalized, then it would be presented to the board. And that concluded our meeting. Any questions? Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, item number 7, discussion and possible action regarding appointment of dental assisting counsel.
Your mic.
Item number 7, discussion and possible action regarding appointment of a dental assisting council member. Tina, are you doing that?
I'll just, so we had a vacancy on the dental assisting council when when Pamela Davis Washington was not interested in seeking an additional term. Board staff put a recruitment notice on the website. Applications were received. President Burton appointed a subcommittee of Rosalinda Ulagi and Dr. Bruce Witcher to review the applications. We set up interviews. Everything is detailed in your memo. There were five people that were interviewed via telephone, and at this point I'll hand it over to the subcommittee for their recommendation.
All five candidates were interviewed and considered thoroughly with me and Dr. Witcher for 30 minutes of an interview. All same five questions were asked to each candidate, and we have a recommendation for the board. That is Melinda Carneras, RDA. Dr. Witcher, in addition?
Again, we had good applicants. We really appreciated people sending in their resumes and supporting information. It was a better group of applicants than we've had in the past, and it seems like it gets better every time. Would really like to emphasize that people should reapply if not selected, that this is, you know, an ongoing process, and we're always looking for people who are interested. So with that, yes, we did come up with a recommendation, so we would submit that to the board. And again, this will be a four-year appointment to the Dental Assisting Council for a practicing RDA position.
The resumes of all the applicants essentially are in your packet, so board members would have had the opportunity to go ahead and look at all the information that the subcommittee reviewed. So at this point, if there are no additional questions, Ms. Burton?
So,
sorry, one question. So if by some chance this candidate couldn't fulfill that, do you have one that's second in line rather than to go back through the process again from this group, or does it go back to
We have a backup.
Okay, thanks.
Lois and I would be able to address that.
And if I understood you, you are recommending Melinda Cazares?
Yes.
Yes, correct.
Okay. If you looked at her background, do any of you have questions? And have a motion to accept?
So move.
Move, Morrow?
Second.
Second, Lai. Secretary, will you call the roll, please?
Burton.
Aye.
Burton, aye. Chan, aye. Chappelle Ingram, absent. Lai.
Yes.
Lai, yes. Laren.
Yes.
Laren, yes. Lai.
Yes.
Lai, yes. McKenzie.
Yes.
McKenzie, yes. Medina, absent. Morrow.
Yes.
Morrow, yes. Ulagi.
Yes.
Ulagi, yes. Pacheco, absent. Stewart?
Yes.
Stewart, yes. Witcher?
Yes.
Witcher, yes. You?
Yes.
You, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Next item is number number eight.
The elective facial cosmetic surgery permit credentialing committee had a vacancy. The committee is composed of three oral surgeons and two physicians. We were having difficulty filling a position that was designated with a specialty in otolaryngology. So Dr. Gallia, who had been a previous member of the EFCS committee, essentially applied for that position because He is a licensed and credentialed in that area. So the board appointed him to that position. That created an additional position, which we were hoping would be easier to recruit for. Essentially, it's an oral surgeon licensed by the medical board. We received two very qualified candidates who were interested in the position. Dr. Witcher reviewed the applications and had telephone discussion with them, and at this point I'll turn it over to Dr. Witcher for his recommendation.
Yes, I've been the board liaison to the committee for some time and have gotten to know all these people quite well, and it was really a privilege to be able to review some applications for appointments. It's not an easy thing to attract people. These clinicians are extremely talented and very busy, and they usually have multiple commitments already. But we did have two applicants. I mean, it's amazing some of the things that these guys are doing. I mean, they're basically practicing as plastic surgeons, plastic and reconstructive surgeons. And so, you know, it was a tough choice because these two people were exceptionally qualified, but in very different ways. I did decide that we would make the recommendation to appoint Dr. Andre Guerrero to the position, and that would be for the oral and maxillofacial surgery spot. The plastic surgery spot has been filled, as has the ENT, with Dr. Gallia assuming that position. He's doubly qualified as an oral surgeon and an ENT surgeon, and he's always been very engaged, really an excellent committee member. So we're lucky to have the talent that we have. They do a terrific job.
Okay, just a correction on page 27, above action requested. The recommendation is to appoint Dr. Guerrero. It doesn't say Guerrero Fernandez. So if you would make that correction, please. And that will be the motion. I'm making the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Lauren. Any questions? Call the roll.
Burton.
Aye.
Burton. Aye. Chan. Aye. Chappell Ingram. Absent. Lai.
Yes.
Lai. Yes. Laren.
Yes.
Laren. Yes. Lay.
Yes.
Lay. Yes. McKenzie.
Yes.
McKenzie. Yes. Medina. Absent. Morrow.
Yes.
Morrow. Yes. Alagi.
Yes.
Yes, Pacheco absent. Stewart?
Yes.
Stewart, yes. Witcher?
Yes.
Witcher, yes. You?
Yes.
You, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 9, discussion and possible action regarding AB 1519, low sunset review. That's on page 145.
Good morning, board members. Wilbert Rumbalo with the dental board. AB 1519, Sunset Review. On July 2nd, 2019, the Dental Board of California's Sunset Review Legislation, Assembly Bill 1519, was amended. The bill was heard in the Senate Business and Professions Committee on July 8th, 2019. The bill was passed out of this committee and referred to the Senate Committee on Appropriations. The bill is scheduled to be heard in Senate Appropriations on Monday, August 12th. A copy of this bill is enclosed for reference. Specifically, the board identified several several sections that we believe were pertinent in regards to the board sunset. And in addition, there were some proposed amendments that board staff has identified that needed to be added to AB 1519.
I'm sorry. Wilbur, do you think we could just start with number one and just briefly go over?
You want to do all of them?
Okay. Yeah, let's go through each item, and then we'll talk about what didn't get in the bill at this point.
Okay. As of July 1st, 2022, it merges the Dental Assistant Fund with the State Dentistry Fund, and the State Dental Assistant Fund shall be abolished. It authorizes each appointing authority rather than only the governor as authorized under current law to remove any appointed member of the board from office at any time who was appointed by that authority for the board member's continued neglect of duty and competency or unprofessional conduct required by the Dental Practice Act.
Let me just intersperse here. So the board hasn't seen this one before. The Dental Practice Act was specific about governor appointees to the board, and that the governor could at any time remove one of its members if he or she chose to do so. And the legislature, as we know, also has appointing power, one each for the Senate and the Assembly. So it was upon their request that they put this additional information in. We would have assumed that the legislature would have equally been able to remove a member that they had appointed for whatever their reasons would have been, but now they wanted to make sure that it was in statute. So this is new. Okay, Wilbert, if you want to continue with three.
It extends the operations of the Dental Board of California and the executive officer until January 1st, 2024.
This is obviously the most important one.
Number four, it requires the notice to consumers to be posted in a conspicuous location, accessible to public view or accessible electronically for patients receiving dental services through telehealth.
Okay, so this is new, and this essentially mirrors the requirement for those dental offices that are brick and mortar dental offices that are required to post the notice. Now this has been introduced in order to require telehealth to do something similar.
Requires the board to appoint its own attorney by July 1st, 2020. Number six specifies applicants applying for dental licensure shall furnish satisfactory evidence of having graduated from a dental college approved by the board or by the Commission on Dental Accreditation of the American Dental Association, and presenting satisfactory evidence of having completed at a dental school or schools the full number of academic years of undergraduate courses required for graduation.
So before you go on, let's just take a little break and ask board members, would you prefer we just go through each one? Do you want us to just slow down and ask if there are any questions? Most of these we've gone over and over again and we've voted on them, so you should be somewhat familiar with them. Should we just continue? I'm seeing nods. So if at the end there are any one of these issues you want to revisit, just let us know and we can go back and give you additional information. Okay, Wilbert, thank you. Continue.
Seven, authorizes the board to deny an application to take an examination for licensure as a dentist or dental assistant, or an application for registration as a dental corporation, or at any time prior to licensure. The board may deny the issuance of a license to an applicant for licensure as a dentist or dental assistant if the applicant has been convicted of crime or subject to formal discipline pursuant to Business and Professions Code 480. Eight, requires applicants for licensure to practice dentistry to provide a signed release allowing disclosure of information from the National Practitioner Data Bank and verification of registration status with the Federal Drug Enforcement Administration. Requires the board to review this information to determine if it is presents sufficient evidence to warrant the submission of additional information from the applicant or the denial of the application for licensure.
I'd like to make a comment on this one because we've already received comments as to whether or not it's actually requiring dentists to have a DEA number, and this does not require them to have a DEA number. We don't require our dentists to have a DEA number. That's up to them to determine whether they want one or not. So go ahead.
Number 9 requires the examination of applicants for a license to practice dentistry in this state shall be sufficiently thorough to test the fitness of the applicant to practice dentistry and shall include assessing competency in the areas of diagnosis, treatment planning, and restorative, endodontic, periodontic, and prosthetic dentistry. Number 10 requires the board to report on how many other states have recognized licensure by portfolio examination at the time of its next sunset review. 11 requires applicants applying for licensure who utilize the clinical and written examination results administered by the Western Regional Examining Board and the American Board of Dental Examiners to have taken and passed such examinations within 5 years prior to the date of their application for licensure. 12 authorizes the board to evaluate a resident's competence to practice dentistry in the state upon successful completion of the advanced education program in general dentistry or advanced education program in residency is required to be within 2 years prior to the date of the resident's application for a license under this section. 13, beginning January 1st, 2020, requires schools seeking approval as a foreign dental school to complete the international consultative and accreditation process with the Commission on Dental Accreditation of the American Dental Association or a comparable accrediting body approved by the board. 14, beginning January 1st, 2024, in order to remain an approved foreign dental school in the state, all schools previously approved by the board as a foreign dental school to have successfully completed the international consultative and accreditation process with CODA or a comparable accrediting body approved by the board. 15 requires a person who applies for licensure as a registered dental assistant shall provide evidence of having successfully completed board approved courses in infection control, the Dental Practice Act, including the Dental Practice Act for dental assisting jurisprudence and basic life support. Number 16, on or after July 1st, 2020, requires a licensee placed on probation to provide a patient or the patient's guardian or healthcare surrogate with a disclosure prior to the patient's first visit if the licensee is on probation for the following: the commission of any act of sexual abuse, misconduct, or relations with a patient or client, drug or alcohol abuse directly resulting in harm to patients or the extent that such use impairs the ability of the licensee to practice safely, criminal conviction involving harm to patient safety or health, or inappropriate prescribing resulting in harm to patients and a probationary period of 5 years or more. 17 requires licensees to obtain a signed copy of the disclosure outlined above from the patient or the patient's guardian or health surrogate. 18 provides an exemption to the disclosure requirement if the patient is unconscious or otherwise unable to comprehend the disclosure and if a guardian or healthcare surrogate is unavailable to comprehend the disclosure and sign the receipt of disclosure. If the visit occurs in an emergency room and the licensee who will be treating the patient during the visit is not known to the patient until immediately prior to the start of the visit, and if the licensee does not have a direct treatment relationship with the patient. 19, on and after July 1st, 2020, the board shall provide information about licensees on the length of probation and probation end date on the licensee's profile page on the board's website.
And just a comment, we already do this, so this isn't really anything new.
20, makes failure to review diagnostic digital or conventional radiographs or other equivalent bone imaging suitable for orthodontia prior to the diagnosis and correction of malpositions of human teeth or use of orthodontic appliances, unprofessional conduct. 21 requires any entity that provides a service authorized under the Act through teledentistry to make the name and state license number of any dentist providing services available at any time prior to or during the rendering of services. 22 specifies that a provider of dental services shall not require a patient to sign an agreement that limits the patient's ability to file a complaint with the board. 23 requires recommendations by the Dental Assisting Council be approved, modified, or rejected by the board within 120 days of submission of the recommendation to the board during full board business. In the event the board rejects, postpones, refers the matter back to the council for any reason, or significantly modifies the intent or scope of the recommendation, the board is required to provide its reasonings in writing for rejecting or significantly modifying the recommendation within 30 days. 24 requires individuals applying for registered dental assistant licensure on or after January 1st, 2010 shall demonstrate satisfactory performance on the registered dental assistant combined written and law and ethics examination. The board suspension of the practical examination shall commence on the date the board votes to suspend the practical examination. And 25 makes numerous technical and clarifying changes to the Act.
Okay, can we stop there? Can we stop there for a minute and ask if their board members have any questions? Laura.
Number nine, my question, I guess I have a comment and then a question. My understanding is that some states do not require all of these components of the of item number nine for licensure, and some of the regional testing agencies are opting in or opting out of some of these categories. So with that said, the question is, are we then going to discriminate, you might say, if a applicant for licensure in California that, say, took the ADEX exam and they optioned out on a certain component, does that mean then that they would not be licensed in California?
Likely, yes.
I just want to make sure that we understand that.
But I mean, your comment was they optioned out.
Right.
So I mean, we had this discussion toward a couple of meetings ago about you know, we have certain requirements listed in our portfolio examination with the competencies, and yet there wasn't anything in statute to essentially define what the expectation was for other examinations. And so this language, which wasn't actually introduced by the board or staff, reflects that discussion that the board had, that perhaps they needed to, the board should be defining what areas they feel should have been tested. The question also came up with REB primarily. That they are letting people option in and out of things. Mm-hmm. And so this is how the language stands at this point.
Okay, I want to make sure that you understand I'm in agreement with this. I'm just wanting to make sure that we understand the ultimate consequences, let's say, of identifying those components of a licensing examination that are required by California, and that if an applicant opted out of one of those categories, that we need to make sure that the results that of the licensing examination that they took fulfills this requirement.
Typically, when we get results from, well, right now we're just dealing with REB, they break out the sections.
Good morning. I have a question on number 14. So it says that in 2024, the foreign dental schools will need to be accredited by CODA. So how are we going to handle the applications of students that, for example, started school this following year and then they finish in 2024? They're spending a lot of time and money and effort on their studies, so we're going to have to inform them immediately, right now, as soon as possible. I don't know when this bill will take place or become effective, but it's really going to affect them, so we need to take care of this.
Well, this bill would go into effect January 1st of 2020, and absolutely, upon the governor's signature, we would be notifying the schools that they need to notify the students that beyond a certain date, essentially the school should not be taking students in. Those who are already in the program would be able to graduate, but they wouldn't be able to be taking people into the program without notifying people that they would no longer have their educational requirement approved.
Okay, so.
We'll have plenty of opportunity to notice everybody.
Because if they started right now, they wouldn't finish until after January 1st, 2024. So that means they're already in there right now.
They're in the program. If they're in the program, then they would be able to. Yes, they will be able to.
As of January.
I believe.
Is that correct?
Staff, do you agree with that? This is the school would no longer have the approval. And it's likely if somebody's in the program now, they'll be finished before the school no longer has the approval.
Correct.
If they're enrolled currently and they have the approval currently, then they would be eligible for licensure in California. But if once the approval goes away, then they would no longer be eligible.
Yeah, we'll work out the details with that. And we certainly will let the schools notify the schools in plenty of time to be able to notify the students.
Okay, so for further clarification, the students that are enrolled as of, say, July 2023, are they eligible to sit for the RAP? Because this requirement doesn't go into effect until January 2024.
I believe that it will likely, we'll have a lot of questions like this that we'll need to answer and the board will need to discuss. Right now we're just talking hypothetical. So we can work that out and come back with a response. I'd rather not do it at this meeting, but if you'd like to try to, if we would like to try to give some guidance to that, I can work with Michael. And we can see if we can give some guidance as to how this is going to work.
Of course, if the school receives CODA approval, the issue will be moot. And we have one school who has engaged in the process and had some deficiencies. And I think with some time by then, we'll probably in advance of them, will be CODA approved. That's the hope.
CODA approved in Saudi Arabia, August 1st.
Oh. A dental school. Really?
August 1st.
I don't want to leave this. It looks like we've got Dr. Stewart and Dr. Chan. I'm trying to think how to best. I guess the best we can do is to say as soon as the governor signs this and we know it's going to go into effect January 1st of 2020, we will be notifying the two schools that are involved. And we'll be working out the plan. And we'll have the numbers clear. We haven't gone that far in the event that this gets taken out along the way. So if at this point you believe that a deadline should be extended out. I suppose we could hear that. So I don't know if that's helpful, but.
I want to go back to Dr. Morrow's concern on point number 9. And I guess the question I have is that, is our communication plan real clear in terms of, you know, speaking to the prospective people taking those exams, that they need to be tested in all those areas so there are no surprises? Are we clear enough on our website? Are we clear enough in our communication to the country?
We can't be clear enough until the legislation passes. So we have to have the authority first to say this. So we couldn't do it. We could prepare to, if the governor signs this, we could prepare to do it and have it ready to go up January 1st of 2020. But until then, no.
I have a question on item number 21. When I read through the legislation itself, is there a calibrated definition of what teledentistry means? In other words, telemedicine typically is diagnostic. You take a picture, you send it over the internet, and then you tell what it is. Does teledentistry means, or the question is whether or not it means delivery of something, a physical something? And then the second part is the question on, it says to make the name and license number of the dentist providing the services. Is the assumption, or should it be stated, that the state license in California, they just provide the state license, it could be anywhere in the country. Our jurisdiction is in California.
To answer your first question, I think that teledentistry has not been clearly defined, and I think that the board will probably be seeing additional information at future meetings to look at teledentistry statutes a little, look into it more deeply. As we know, there have been concerns for procedures that are out there that are direct to consumer. And other portions of that type of delivery of dental care. And so this essentially has been established to start to clarify what teledentistry is. I know that there's a newly formed teledentistry association. I am very curious about how you perform dentistry teledentistry. It is different from telehealth. And so I think that the board will probably, we will be having this on future agendas to discuss. Right now, these are things that were put in not by board staff, but that we have reviewed and believe that the board should support these ideas because essentially it's requiring teledentistry to comply with the same requirements as a brick and mortar store or office, excuse me, of a dentist. Notification to consumers. I think part of the problem with teledentistry's implementation is oftentimes the patient doesn't know who the dentist is and how to get a hold of the dentist, and so that seems to be a serious problem. Does that answer your question, Dr. Chan?
For the first part, the second part is the jurisdiction.
The jurisdiction is supposedly, any California patient should be treated by a California dentist. But if you feel that this needs to be further clarified, we could submit that information to the legislature. Also, in the event that some of the recommendations can't make it into this bill, we do have the opportunity to continue to vet certain circumstances and to move forward with legislation in the future of our own.
Yeah. Just to answer that, how can you do dentistry through teledentistry. Yeah, you see, so right now in development, there is 5G. You can do surgery with 5G over the telephone lines by remote and a remote transmitter in the mouth. That's being developed in China right now.
My concern, I want to echo a concern regarding teledentistry and dentistry being conducted by a dentist outside of California. Something that I know is being done now in the area of dental radiology. A number of organizations and dentists take CT scans, send them electronically to a dental radiologist out of state. That dental radiologist makes the diagnosis and gives a report. The diagnosis is part of treating of dentistry, the practice of dentistry. Therefore, this individual who is out of state making a diagnosis from electronically submitted CT scans or radiographic images is practicing dentistry. And that individual is not within the state of California. So that's happening right now.
I would just ask, do you know for certain that while the image may be submitted across state lines, that the person reviewing it doesn't have a California license?
I know one specific instance where the individual does not have a California license.
Okay. It's likely we'll agendize that for a future meeting.
Anything else?
I just wanted to make a quick comment regarding Dr. Morrow's comment. I think when we send in a CBCT X-ray to a company that reads, the X-rays, they will provide the interpretation of the X-rays, not necessarily the diagnosis. Because usually in the interpretation, it would have differential diagnosis. The dentist who's seen the patients will have to make the diagnosis. So that is my understanding. So I don't think that they're really making the diagnosis, they're interpreting the findings. And we who see the patients will have to make that diagnosis. So I just wanted to put that out there.
That's a fine distinction, and I agree with you that an interpretation by a radiologist is not necessarily a diagnosis, but in some instances a diagnosis is made. This is consistent with such and such and such. That's a diagnosis. Okay.
Yes.
Let's take it one step further. If we have someone that doesn't have a California license interpreting the results of a CT or any kind of radiograph and interprets it incorrectly, then something happens to the patient because of that incorrect diagnosis, we have no recourse for that person.
I think in this particular case, since we're talking about dental radiology, we will include this as a future agenda item that will encompass perhaps teledentistry. And if board members have any additional things that they would like added to this agenda item, if you'll send me a note, and we will start doing the research and put together something for a future agenda item.
No other questions, let's move then into the proposed amendments to section.
After reviewing the proposed proposed amendments that were published in the bill on July 2nd. Board staff noticed a series of amendments that would assist in executing the board's issues that were identified in the Sunset Review background report that we had previously submitted. Some of, and then also we identified some amendments that had been taken that would create issues for the board's execution and administration of the laws as proposed. The first one was to delete amendments to retain the original language relating to the term dental auxiliary, specifically in section 1628.5, 1628.7, and 1684.5. The term dental auxiliary encompasses all license types, and utilizing the term dental assistant, which is a specific licensure category that does not require a license, could cause confusion. And so we've requested that the committee staff return that back to the original language. Additionally, we've requested that Business and Professions Code section 1634.1 be amended to state that the completion of the program shall be within 2 years prior to the date of their application for a license under this section, to clarify that the residency must be completed within 2 years of application. This was what the board had asked for in the new issues. As it relates to the language relating to foreign dental schools, staff requested a few amendments to help clarify the transitional process. Specifically, we requested adding Business and Professions Code section 1636.4C2 to include the following language: if the board does not contract for the evaluation pursuant to subdivision B, no technical advisory group shall be established, and the evaluation team for the school site shall provide its report directly to the board. Additionally, we requested that Business and Professions Code section 1636.4H be added to include: an application submitted under this section must be deemed a complete application pursuant to the rules promulgated by the board prior to January 1st, 2020 in order to be accepted. And notwithstanding any other law, a school required to submit a renewal application after January 1st of 2020 shall not submit that application and shall be deemed approved until January 1st of 2024, subject to the continued compliance of the school as described in Subdivision E. Additionally, there was language included in the bill that would create a barrier to licensure, so staff has requested that the proposed requirement in Business and Professions Code section 1645.1 for an applicant for an RDA license to complete a Dental Practice Act course for dental assisting jurisprudence be removed. This course does not exist, and requiring it as of January 1st of 2020 would create a barrier to licensure, as no one would be able to find the course to take. Additionally, we requested that we add a provision to Business and Professions Code section 1718.3 to allow the license holder to apply for a new license to replace a canceled license through one of the available licensure pathways. Specifically, staff recommended the language state the license holder applies for licensure as a new applicant through one of the available licensing pathways and meets all of the requirements for licensure outlined therein. This was an issue that was discussed during the board's background report, and this language was previously approved by the board at a meeting a couple of years ago.
And it just was inadvertently left out by Assembly BMP Committee. They had intended to put it in.
Additionally, there were amendments made to section 1742 relating to the board's requirements to respond to the Dental Assisting Council recommendations. Board staff recommended these be deleted because current language is sufficient.
That references back to, was it number 23?
Correct.
So that comment on number 4 references back to number 23 on page 148.
At this point, staff recommends that the board take a support position of Assembly Bill 1519.
Move Morrow. Second.
Second.
Second Lay. Are there any additional questions? Are there any public comments?
Good morning, Alan Felsenfeld, CDA. We are very comfortable with the provisions of 1519 and the amendments that you have proposed this morning. On a personal basis, a personal note, having been to many of these meetings, I think this, all of the things that come through this bill, when it is signed or if it is signed, I think will facilitate the work of this board and save you a lot of time on some of the issues that I've had heard a lot of debate on in the last couple of years. So we're in support.
Thank you.
Good morning, Missy Johnson.
Good morning.
There you go. You can hear me now. Good morning, Missy Johnson with Nielsen Merksamer here on behalf of Universidad de La Salle. Clearly, the school is disappointed in the board's decision to end its foreign school approval process. As we've spent many years working with the board and we've developed a very good working relationship, they are concerned about the transition process, so I am happy to hear that that is something that the board is going to consider looking at and hopefully make very clear to the students. Clearly, that is the university's concern, and we will be seeking amendments to the language or amendments to AB 1519 that make it clear that the graduates of the approved programs will be eligible for licensure. We believe there is some ambiguity in the bill. I think that might have played out a little bit in the discussion here before the board, but we have approached the chair of the Assembly BNP committee. We've had very productive conversations in that regard, and so we just wanted to let the board know that we would be seeking that sort of clarification. Thank you.
Claudia Pohl, CDAA. We too are very comfortable with the amendments that are proposed, with the exception of number four, and that's relative to 1742H and the board's responsiveness and requirement to the Dental Assisting Council. And we would prefer to see the original language or the language that's in there now to remain as is. There has been in the past not always a responsiveness from the dental board back to the council for actions that are taken. And so we would prefer to see that language left.
Anyone else? Okay, let's call for a question.
Burton?
Aye.
Burton, aye. Chan, aye. Chappelle Ingram, absent. Lai?
Yes.
Lai, yes. Laren?
Yes.
Laren, yes. Lay?
Yes.
Lai, yes. McKenzie?
Yes.
McKenzie, yes. Medina, absent. Morrow?
Yes.
Morrow, yes. Alagi?
Yes.
Alagi, yes. Pacheco, absent. Stewart?
Yes.
Stewart, yes. Witcher?
Yes.
Witcher, yes. You?
Yes.
You, yes.
Motion passes. And it passes, meaning support of.
Thank you, everybody. This has been quite a process. So I'm happy to see that we're moving along with this. We're going to go back now. I see President Good, and so we're going to go back now to the dental hygiene report. And that is item number four.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone.
Hello.
Thank you for accommodating our schedule here and taking the delay. Really appreciate that. And thank you also for the opportunity to report on our Dental Hygiene Board's activities since your May 2019 board meeting. I'm Susan Good, and I'm the president of the Dental Hygiene Board, and I'm here along with our executive officer, Anthony Lum. We've been busy with the following items. First, we're continuing the review of all of the dental hygiene educational programs, and we're gaining solid cooperation from them as we continue our efforts. Schools we've recently visited have only had minor deficiencies that were easily corrected to comply with the law. One school is recruiting for a new program director, and once that position is filled, and they fix a minor infection control issue, they'll be in full compliance. Our budget change proposals were approved as of July 1st, and we're now in the process of filling three additional positions. One position will help to enhance our enforcement efforts for citation and fines, and the other two will help to improve our processes for license renewal, continuing education, and also applications for licensure. Once these positions are filled, the board will have the largest staff ever on payroll in our short history. And we're also continuing to work on several regulatory packages that are in the review phase, such as interim therapeutic restorations, ITR, mobile dental clinics for RDHAPs, AB 2138 and its effect on our enforcement processes, and the retired license category. We also have a few new packages that are in draft form, waiting review by the board at our next meeting, which is in November. But at this time, I'd ask Anthony to provide a brief update on the ITR regulation.
Morning, Madam President, board members. If you recall at your May board meeting, I presented the draft version of our regulatory language for interim therapeutic restoration and radiographic decision making. And we had a very extensive conversation, longer than I expected, but it clarified a lot of issues, and I'm glad we did have that very informative session. There were three subsequent changes or small revisions that we made to the language, but one in particular stood out where we interjected the term interim into a portion of our language, and that's what we had the lengthy discussion about. Since that time, with all you all enlightening me as far as what that term could confuse people, we have since decided to eliminate that term and proceed forward with the language mimicking what's in the pilot project. So for purposes of moving forward with that regulatory package, that term is removed. The language now mimics the pilot project, and hopefully we can just go forward. If there are any further concerns with this package when you review the language, there will be a 45-day public comment period that we would gladly accept comments on the regulation. Thank you.
Then our next topic is outreach. With us now being a board, we've found that many people don't know who or what we are, including our licensees, other agencies, and more than likely the public. So the only groups that seem to recognize us are the dental hygiene educational programs and the Dental Hygiene Association. So we plan to increase our outreach efforts in the next few years to improve recognition and also let groups know that we exist and that we're available for their assistance. And then lastly, we voice this in every report to you, but it's worth mentioning again. And that is that we really, really appreciate the ongoing communication and cooperation between our two programs and the strong relationship we have with one another. We enjoy your report at our meetings. Your president reported to us at our April meeting. And we extend an invitation to you to report at our November 22nd or 23rd meeting in Southern California. It's going to be held somewhere around the Burbank Glendale area. That hasn't been finalized yet, but we hope that we'll be able to see you there. And that concludes our report. Any questions?
What's your total staff?
With the approved BCPs, we'll have a total of 13.
14.
13.
Okay. Mm-hmm. 13, okay.
Anyone else?
Anything else?
I just have one small additional comment. Of course, you all as the dental board recognizes us too, so thank you.
Anything else? Well, thank you.
I like that addition he had. We know that. Thank you.
Okay, so now we are at enforcement and review of enforcement statistics and trends.
Good morning, board members. Carlos Alvarez, Enforcement Chief, and I'm here to present the fourth quarter statistics. And so currently right now in the complaints and compliance unit, complaints received, we have 1,142 complaints. And so this was an increase of approximately 161 cases from the last quarter. So the monthly average complaints received for the quarter four was 380. And the complaint cases that are currently open right now is 833. So there's total 833 complaints cases that are pending with the complaint compliance unit. And this is, again, the process of ordering the records and the process of waiting for, you know, patient authorization to receive records. So that's what some of the, it consists of. Consists of also that files are with the dental consultants that are reviewing the cases. So that's what's pending right now with the complaint compliance unit. And so the complaints that are pending have decreased by 11% from the third quarter. So these numbers have been dropping. And like I said, I'm just happy that all this is working out in CCU, the reduction of cases, the reduction in the case aging. I mean, it's remarkable numbers that we have and that we continue to report each quarter.
And I'd like to just comment, the emphasis here is that what this decrease of 11% means is they're working the cases more quickly and moving them on more quickly. So we've seen over the last 9 months a consistent ability for this unit to process things more efficiently and more quickly. So this is good news in terms of our total time frame to be able to complete a case. Thank you, Carlos.
And sir, right now in the unit complaint cases closed, it's 971. So during the fourth quarter, there was 971 total complaint cases that were closed. And so the average cases closed per month was 324. And the, again, just going back, a complaint took an average of 95 days to close, and which the last quarter, it's 64 days faster than the last quarter. So again, this is with the process, dental consultants of reviewing the reports, getting them back faster, going back to the units and closing these cases out. So it's great. And so currently right now in investigations, we have cases open investigations, it's 569 cases. And we have 35 open inspection cases. So comparing to this quarter, there has been a significant decrease in number of open cases. So it's been a reduction of 24%. And so as if you're looking at the tables here, investigation aging for fiscal year 2018-2019, we've really been working on reducing the numbers from the 1 to 3 years. So we've really been working this together, trying to expedite these cases so we don't lose any statutes, and we try to, you know, close these cases out as fast as we can. So currently we closed out 300 cases during the fourth quarter. So the average cases per month was 100 cases that we closed out, and that's the average. And currently right now for the total number of investigations cases that were closed, filed with the Attorney General's office or District Attorney's office was 23 cases. So the average number of days to complete the investigation during the fourth quarter was 464 days. So this is 34 days slower. And again, when I get into, when I get in slower, I don't really like that word slower. But like I said, it's something that we're working on. There's other things too that we could take into account with vacancies that we have and the shuffling of cases. Again, setting new priorities, and that's what we do with the vacant positions. Is what are the cases that are left? We go over it, read them, and we reprioritize and we reassign them to new investigators. So currently right now in the administrative and disciplinary action, We had a total of 80 citations, and this is an increase. And the reason that this is an increase, because it's a combination of enforcement and the licensing unit. So the licensing unit did CE audits, so they issued citations because for the licensees not meeting their requirements. So there was, so enforcement issued 21 citations, and 59 were from the licensing unit for not meeting like the CEs. So that's why there was an increase. And so therefore we have 19 accusations that were filed with the Attorney General's office. And so in total, there was 23 cases that were referred to the Attorney General's office. And this is a combination of the 19 accusations and also with statement of issues, petition to revoke probation. That's what the 23 cases involved here. And so currently right now, there's 137 cases pending at the Attorney General's office since July 19th of 2019.
Are there fines associated with the disciplinary actions? Fines?
Yes. Yes, there is. So there's fines that we issue. So some of the examples, again, record keeping, we issue fines for that. The CE's audits that they conducted, they also issued fines for that as well.
Now, just to reiterate, a citation and a fine is not discipline. It's like a fix-it ticket. So typically what we're doing with the CE audits is the fine is $750. Part of it goes to the fact that they attested upon their renewal that they had their 50 hours complete, and then the other part essentially is that they don't have their 50 hours complete. Similarly, when we don't get records in a timely way, respondents have 15 days to respond. We charge them $250 a day for not receiving the records, up to $5,000. And that's all written out in statute and regulation.
Is that also on our website?
I don't think so.
No, it's not.
Because I know a majority of the dentists in California probably don't know that.
Which part?
Fines and, you know, if they're not compliant with CEs and how they don't know what happens if they don't, so they throw out a number and submit it. So I don't know if it's a good way for us to get some message out, maybe help with the CDA or help with
Well, when it comes to the records, as Karen mentioned, as when we're requesting records, we do mention that in the letter that per the Business of Professions Code, they have 15 days to meet. And we also discuss the fines in the request for the letter, so they know once they receive it, they have 15 days, and they know what the Business of Professions Codes are for not meeting that deadline.
I think Dr. Lai was maybe saying that the CEs
okay.
that dentists might not be aware that they have to be truthful and they have to actually complete 50 units. And so, yes, we can certainly work with associations to get that word out.
I think that would be, you know, helpful in keeping people compliant and also up to date. And so in the future, we don't have problems with, you know.
Well, tongue in cheek, I would say, once they get their citation, I don't think they're going to make that mistake again. But, you know, that's one way of communicating.
Thank you.
So. I don't think your mic is on.
That's kind of when there's a complaint and that's not founded complaint, and there's an investigation, and you go do all your work, and there's nothing that you find. Who pays for this? Is it the dental board, or do we still charge the dentist or whoever's being accused?
No, we don't charge anything. If there's no errors, so the process is that we gather all the records, we submit that to a dental consultant. That's like the first phase. And if it comes back that there is no errors in the treatment, then we close the case out. And so, therefore, we don't send a payment or anything like that. We don't.
That's what your licensing fee pays for, our licensing and enforcement.
Continue on. So with probation cases, so we have approximately 187 probation cases that we have. And so the three-month average for disciplinary cases to be completed was 1,051 days. So this is 280 days faster than the previous quarter. And again, this is working with the Attorney General's office as well in order to improve these numbers. And so with the numbers, with the breakdown, total number of active probationers, we have 148, and we have 39 that are tolling. So for Sacramento Enforcement Office, there's 34 active probationers, 18 probationers that are tolling. And in orange, there's 95 active probationers, 15 probationers that are tolling. And so therefore, in our investigative analysis unit here in Sacramento, there's 19 active probationers. So each unit handles probationers. So there's six probationers tolling.
Carlos?
Yes.
Tolling?
Tolling, yes. So there's 39 that are tolling, total.
Which means?
So which means that they're either out of state or they're not working per their conditions. So therefore, their time kind of stops, and we monitor that. And so once we get contacted, they're back in the state, they're working and everything, then their probation will start again. So on page, I just want to bring something up on page 212 on chart number 2. We did change our numbers of cases pending at the AG because the last quarter we reported 272 cases that were pending at the Attorney General's office, and that was kind of an inaccurate number. And we kind of worked these numbers again, so the actual numbers were 145 cases that were pending at the Attorney General's office. So that falls along the lines that what we've been reporting. And so we had a high number that I reported the last time, but we cleaned that up, and we kind of added that to our chart.
I think Dr. Witcher brought it to our attention last time that it was a substantially higher number, and so we went back. What we're finding in terms of getting our statistics is we have to, and we're implementing a plan to double and triple check the numbers that we bring forward, because we get numbers out of breeze, we get numbers out of the air, we get numbers by count. You know, we actually go to investigators and get certain things. So we're looking at this more closely in an attempt to bring you the most accurate records that we believe are the most accurate statistics and records moving forward. But you can see that now the number falls more in line with what the trends have been in the past. So thank you for looking at it and bringing it to our attention.
On under investigations, under those cases referred for criminal, and I know we've sort of kind of talked about this before, but can you give an example of a case that may be referred as opposed to a case that we get and there's already been some criminal adjudication?
Okay, so if we send a case out, so when there's been adjudication, so I'm kind of thinking where what we're saying, subsequent arrest report, that's where I'm kind of assuming where it's been adjudicated and from the court system. And so we get that, we get all the court records, and we still submit that to the Attorney General's office as well for discipline, because their cases have been adjudicated. We gather all those records because, again, so now what we have to do is now do the administrative portion to discipline the license, and that's what we do, is once a case has been adjudicated, so like subsequent arrest. Correct. Even if there's a dismissal, we can still move forward with discipline.
Yeah, that's actually a really good question, because I look at if we file an accusation, do an investigation, and come up with what would be deemed criminal activity, send it to the DA, unlicensed practice of dentistry, for example. I think that's very different from taking a subsequent arrest that's you know, comes to us through the system that we then investigate.
Yeah.
That's kind of, we're taking one on the front end and the other on the back end, to, so to speak. And, you know, are we lumping those together? Because, you know, I see on average we're doing about 14%. When I look across here, usually criminal referral is a very low number, but here it jumps up in Q3. So either we took a lot of subsequent arrest reports or we filed a lot of cases. It's just, I don't know that we need to have a breakdown, but it's just interesting to know how these things.
Yeah, because we do get a large numbers of subsequent arrests. We do get a large numbers of those. Then, like I said, if there is unlicensed activity, so let's just say it's someone that's working on a scope, we can consider that unlicensed activity, then we'll submit that. Instead of doing a criminal, we'll just submit that to the administratively, because they already have a license and they're just working on a scope.
Right.
I think we're going to take another look at this line and we'll report back at the next meeting.
Yes. If there isn't more questions, I'll go into 10B with cures. I'm sorry.
I do have a couple questions. Going back to your complaint and compliance unit, I seem to recall at one point we were really down people in the CCU. We'd lost a couple of seasoned people, and the unit was, we had to recruit and hire and train a bunch of people. And I'm wondering if we're now seeing the fruit of that with the numbers coming down.
So, it was the process. So we identify the process, because actually right now we're still low in that unit, just with office technicians. But it was the process that was developed by the managers. And so they identified what the process was, they changed it, and they were able to bring down these numbers where we didn't really need, you know, to bring in more staff. It was just the process that they did, and they identified it. They started setting down, you know, dates in order to accomplish it. And so that's why these numbers have come down, is because it was the process.
So again, it's an example of not necessarily needing more people, just using them in a better way, which that's
correct.
A good thing.
It was using them and using the time appropriately. Yeah. And setting timelines for each of the process in the complaint compliance unit.
I can't say it enough. This is huge. And it's just the first unit. Well, actually, it's the second unit, because we actually accomplished this in our licensing unit, where at some point the analysts felt that they had so much work and we needed to bring on more people. And I made a pledge, essentially, when I took over, that we were going to ensure that we were really doing everything we could as efficiently before we hired additional people. So changing over the processes, doing more accountability of what work is actually being completed within the day, holding our staff accountable. The staff has really rallied and has shown what they can do, and we don't need to increase staffing in order to accomplish that, even despite the fact that we do see vacancies often in a lot of the units. Contrary to what some have said, when we do have vacancies, the remaining people don't get doubled up on work. Their workload remains the same, so they're not requested to take on additional work. It's just distributed in a different way. So it's very promising. We're seeing our numbers. We will be moving into the investigative unit, and then at the end through the sworn unit. We're hoping to bring all of these recommended process changes forward, and we are very excited about the prospect of actually being, for the first time, to be able to open and close cases within the time frame that was established years ago. So fingers are crossed, and preliminarily, a shout out to staff, particularly in licensing unit and CCU. You're doing an awesome job. And I have no doubt that once we get into the additional units, they'll respond in a similar way. So it's really coming together.
Okay, so I'll move into agenda item 10B, which is cures registration. and currently right now, Dental Board of California currently has 34,404 active licensed dentists. And currently right now with the registration with Cures, as of June of 2019, we have 15,156. And so that was an increase of 300 registrants from the time that reported from February of 2019. So it's been working, the Cures, they've been registering, and like I said, we have an increase of 300. So that is the good news. And also to report is the Cures usage. And so the Department of Justice actually changed the reports and the statistics. Recently, when I reported the last quarter, I reported patient activity reports, like how many were created. And so the Department of Justice moved away from that, and they want to actually see if the DDSs or the prescribers have been looking at the patient activity reports. So they changed the reports now. And so then for the month of April, there was 6,986 patient activity reports that were searched. And so then with the Cures, with the system that's been accessed, this is a little bit lower than what with the patient activity search that's been reported as they're searching. So it's one login. So a DDS could log in one time and do multiple searches on one time. So that's why the patient activity reports are much higher than the usage. So it's one time, they go in, they do multiple searches. So that's what DOJ wanted to see, is that they're logging on and looking at the patient activity reports. And so for the month of April, there were 6,986 patient activity reports that were searched. In May, there was 6,731. Then in June of 2019, there was 5,944 patient activity reports. Then as the system was accessed, then April of 2019, 5,531. May of 2019, 5,393. And then in June of 2019, there was 4,676 total times Cures was accessed. But I hope everybody understands that they could log on and do multiple searches at one time.
It's really, to me, awesome to see this. It took a long time to get to this point. This is just absolutely awesome. We did have, and I can remember specifically, Dr. Seward, that you raised this issue about getting in and kind of navigating wasn't seamless. Is that, are you hearing that that's better in terms of the ability of dentists to get in and kind of navigate the system?
Yes, there has been improvement on that, all aspects with the Cures, like making it easier to understand. And that's why part of it, like I said, it's, the numbers have been increasing with the registrants,
yeah,
and the system being used, so it's being more user-friendly.
But the other part for me, because numbers and accuracy of numbers is everything, to look at this and see the prescriptions and the number of prescriptions and which schedule they're on takes away the vagueness that we've had in the past. And so I'm happy that we've finally gotten to this point.
Yeah, and as we go on, you can see that the numbers have been decreasing with prescriptions for opiates. It's been decreasing once as I get into the next one, because I'm presenting with the prescriptions that were filled. And this is from all the prescribers that by month to month that was prescribed by schedules. And so then Schedule 2, as you know, Schedule 2 has the highest potential for drug abuse. And the Schedule 2s, that's some of the examples that Schedule 2s involve is your Vicodin, your oxycodone. And so from May to June with the Schedule 2s, there has been a 10% reduction with that. And actually all the schedules, there has been a reduction. So with the schedules threes, fours, and fives, as you can see, there's been like a 9% reduction, 6% in the schedule fives. So all the education, all the literature that's out there, all these databases, it is working here, because as you can see that the schedule twos, like I said, I go back, that has the highest potential for drug abuse. It's a there's a 10% reduction rate here. So I think that's great, just like as long as like President Fran Burton was
and
saying.
And so then for, I also remember these discussions a few years ago about, oh no, we're not a part of the problem. You know, you see this number, and you see this raw number, and kind of blows you away.
Right. Now, like you said, now we have numbers to show right. that, yes, it's been working here, and that we have been reducing numbers to work with the opiate abuse. So it's been working here. And the other thing that that is new, that it's in the one of the things I didn't report was the health desk statistics. Those numbers were inaccurate. That was reported from Department of Justice to DCA. Those numbers were inaccurate, so therefore I didn't have any numbers to present as to show how many times you know they actually called Department of Justice to get help on the CURES system. So those numbers I'm not reporting on this quarter. But there also has been something new that's in the system now. So what they created now, Department of Justice, if you look at the registration statistics on page 3, you see that there's now a column which is addressed IEWS. And what that is a information exchange web service now. And so what that entails is it's a database. So let's say with an example, the larger healthcare facilities, an example like Kaiser, they have their own database. They log on to their database. And so now they're able to access CURES through their own database. And so DOJ is allowing that now. But in order to have this, you have to sign in an agreement with the Department of Justice, so a memorandum, you have to sign it. There's also questions that you have to answer. There's fees that are associated with this. So now that's also available, that now you can have your own database, access it, and then you could obtain cures through it. But again, it's through an agreement with the Department of Justice.
I just wanted clarification on one thing. We have the number of prescriptions filled by schedule. That's across all prescribers?
That's all prescribers.
Not just dentists.
Not just dentistry.
It'd
that's
be interesting to see what our percentage is.
Yeah,
but
that would have been high. Yeah, it would have been too high if it was just PDSs. Yeah, but that's all prescribers.
Right.
That the we're reporting on.
Hello, Carlos. I was just at an opioid seminar, and it was pretty very interesting. But a person from that works in the state, I think it was, mentioned that the medical board calls all physicians where there has been an overdose death. They actually, when they know that this overdose death from opioids that was prescribed from a physician that is a member, I mean, that's registered with the medical board, they actually call them and alert them and let them know that there was a death. I don't know if we have that opportunity, or do we even know if there's a death related to any opioid prescriptions by dentists?
We do have that requirement, business of professions code, yeah, 1680Z, where it's hospitalization or death. So they have to report it to us within 7 days. So we do get notified. And once we do get notified, we automatically open up a case and we make it a priority.
So those that they...
Yeah, it's business of professions code. It's written. They have 7 days to notify us. Yes.
Just for clarification, the medical board is contacted if they don't know that their patient has had an overdose death?
If you did some treatment on the patient, I know you have to inform them if they went to the hospital. But would they know that there was a death related to opioid prescription by the dentist? I don't know. I'm not sure.
But then that also, if they get transport and everything, it's also the DDS's obligation is to check in with the facility. And there is, the process is when we're contacting them on those type of cases that they have been in contact with the facility, or the facility contacting them, or sometimes it's the next of kin that contacts the dental office to give them the information that if the patient had passed away.
Okay.
No other questions, then we'll move up to the update. So on the last board meeting, it was inquired about the e-scripts requirements. So Assembly Bill 2789, which is Wood, and which is Business and Professional Code 688, is that healthcare practitioners shall have the capability to issue written electronic prescriptions. So they have to do this by January 1st of 2022. And so that was the question that came up, is when was the date? And with the e-prescriptions, and that's with BMP, Business Professional Code 688, is that healthcare practitioners shall have the capability to send and receive electronic prescriptions by this date.
Ross?
And so just to reiterate, new prescriptions pads, January 1st, 2020.
For new,
the new
security?
Secured.
Yes, because that was extended.
Extended to January 1st, 2020.
Yeah. And so then I also called the pharmacy board. And so what they also advised me that oral telephone prescriptions or hard copy prescriptions will still be valid as well.
For all schedules?
For all schedules.
Until next year.
Correct.
Thank you.
So before we go into the next item, we're going to stop for lunch. And we're ready? Are we ready?
Pahud, what's the deal? Do we, so the board members put their orders in, do they just go to the restaurant and give a name or?
They should have lunch ready by 12 o'clock, so okay. The orders, they have been put in already, so they should be ready by now.
Okay.
And then they'll pay separately after they pick up their orders.
Okay.
Okay. So if we can stop now, and we'll come back at 1. 1 o'clock, everybody.
We'd like to keep...